Peter Walker, and a web designer, and talking about HTML5 today in WordPress. There's a URL at the very bottom here, so there's a sample page on there, so it gives a little demonstration of some of the things I'll be talking about today, so you can check it out on your laptop or on your phone. Going over a little bit of review, since it's been a while since I've done this with the group, with the WordPress. At this point in time, a little over 20%, almost 25% of all websites use WordPress. So it's a pretty good forum in which you could do online HTML5 development. Initially it was for the creation of blogs, but now it's a full content system. And it's also evolving into a mobile application system. So it's continuously evolving. And the front end, of course, is HTML5, CSS3, and JavaScript. Usually jQuery, but jQuery Mobile is making a lot of headway. And what's the other one? I think it's Zerk. It's one of the foundation ones. I think it's Zend Foundation. It's a lot of headway. The basic sections of an HTML of a WordPress page is header, content, and footer. And the sidebar is optional. And so, what are WordPress themes? They're a set of files delivered dynamically from a database to the with the HTML5 page with CSS styling. The basic theme is, of course, two pages, and the default themes is three of them, is 2012, 2013, and 2014, which each theme, the later it gets, the more responsive web design is employed. I basically like to go with a mobile-first philosophy with all of the development these days with the mobile, especially since it's going over to the to applications. There, at last count, there was something like over 600 devices, mobile devices. So I guess I will kind of address that a little bit later on in the talk. Instead of doing hard pixels, you do microsecond. And we also have to think of the UI, the user interface, and the user experience. Adaptive design, that's basically what's going on. You hear responsive design, but adaptive design is how your design goes into the device. And it's off the browser. Most, I guess, pretty well all of you, you move your browser around, right? And you move it to different sizes. It's adaptive. The design is actually adapted to your screen size. That's where adaption comes through. And it's mostly done through media queries. The media queries, I have a couple of examples from the Mozilla Developer Network. And of course, their entire system, operating system, is based on HTML5 with the Amazon phone. It's all HTML5. Here's an example of a 2013 iPhone in the portrait. Have an example here with the tablets in the portrait. It's about to dust it off an iPad mini and also iPhone 4 with the landscape. And then, of course, you have the desktop. Now, using CSS3 and SVG in WordPress, I'll be addressing this with some plugins that developers have put out in WordPress. The three which I'll be referring to is the child theme generator, animated, and WordPress icons, which are SVG. And there's that link again, that's the direct page link. If you just go to the front part, in the menu will be the date of 2014-10-22. That page you just click on. That's the definition of a child theme. And why a child theme is really important is usually if you get a parent theme, there's lots of free parent themes. I think if you go to the Codex, they have 22,000 free parental themes. So it's like a framework. You don't have to reinvent the wheel. However, if you want to do edits, it's not recommended to do edits in the parent. The reason being is that you have security issues. You can also have your main theme fall apart. And then, of course, the third and the biggest one is that you might work a lot and do a lot of stuff on your parent theme, and suddenly they have an update, and all of your changes are wiped out as soon as you apply that update. And usually you have to apply that update because security. Okay, so it's always a good idea to go with the child themes. And one of the plugins is the child theme configurator. So I don't know if you can see it too well there. What they have, you're able to do, basically you could take in stuff from the main theme and adapt it. Now, how the page usually loads up in terms of a child theme, the child theme will usually load in before the parent theme, so when the parent comes in, the child things that you put in there are already there, and the parent will adapt to those parameters. This is the query selector. This is where you can write your own code and do edits within the plugin. The next plugin is one called Page Transition. So a lot of publishers are using, they're building their books, and usually they'll have like a page turn. They will have that transition. This is a plugin that you can do such things. I think there are 9 of them. You do fade out. The usual suspects. And then, of course, you have the WordPress icons, SVG. And on the page there, if you're over by the website, the page, you'll notice that it has a few of these icons in there. I just put them up there. Whichever ones I put up for example, just so you can see it. Okay, these are. Of course, on the back end of WordPress, within Linux, Windows, Mac. It's basically Apache, MySQL, and PHP. All very basic and easy to do, well, relatively easy to do. Your APIs, so the little definition of an API, that's how most of the plugins now in WordPress, they work off APIs. And as you guys know, the APIs are still quite a bit of flux. How many guys went to the Foundry in July?
Which event was that?
AT&T Foundry?
Which event was it? Like public safety hackathon, or was
yes,
it
was kind of like the hackathon, the AT&T.
Yeah.
It was in July. Yeah. Which we were working on their API. Of course, the documentation. Most developers did not like the document. Things are usually changing so fast that the documentation we got, it was done, I think it was done 10 days before, and only 60% of it was applicable. So if you're looking for documentation for APIs, sorry. You guys get that. That's just the way it is. And animated settings. This is another plugin too. On the page, when the page loads in, it'll start bouncing. Parts of it will bounce. That's the animated settings. So you can move your page. Our speaker time will be talking about more what you can do with SVG. And okay, this is the editor. in which I put that page together with some of the code. I used more Epsom text, usual dummy text, and so that's the text. But at the very top is the code where it has Ed's animation equals bounce, delay equals 4, duration is 20, and the infinite animation is no. So it just bounces and then stops. And the icons, the text for the icons are in spam data. So you see spam and then the data icon, and then it gives the icon. Okay. And that's what the page should look like. If you called it up. Middle section should be bouncing when you first land. I didn't put the transitions in because I thought it might be a little bit too much to have the transition, to have the bouncing and then the transitions also. And this link is a little link for the WordPress APIs for plugins. It's a little guide when it comes to documentation. This is one of the better bets of actually getting stuff so you can have a look at them. And that's the end of the presentation. Everything that you see here in the plugins are all free plugins, so you can just download and start testing. Thank you. Any questions?
So, does a child theme work for any theme, or does a theme have to be built to work with a child theme?
Child theme can work on anything. Anything. Because basically what a child theme is the edits and the changes that you want to do, or your client, or your boss, or whoever, they all have ideas. That's what you put in. You also put in the child theme. I know that some guys will have, they'll have a number series of child themes, and then they just load it in during testing until they decide to merge it all.
So I'm trying to migrate my site on WordPress.com to my auto-hosted WordPress site. I have a hard time figuring out what plugins, a list of plugins that you use, so you can install on WordPress. Do you have any idea?
Usually, there's two schools of thought on this. If you talk to a lot of the sysops on how many plugins you should have, depending on what they have going back with their system, they might say, oh, okay, anywhere from 3 to 10. However, if you check over on Matt, on Matt's site, the guy who came up with WordPress, he has like oodles of plugins. So there's really what you get, I guess what you have to kind of do is just, I would advise just to write a little document of what you want the site to do, and then to find plugins that will do that.
Well, in terms of
front end, you should really stick with HTML5, CSS, and JavaScript.
Well, I guess my question is that I want it looks exactly the same on the admin side. I'm trying to figure out what plugins WordPress.com use.
Oh, like the Jetpack?
Yeah, I don't know what plugins they use.
The Jetpack is the big plugin that when you change over from WordPress.com to your own hosting, a lot of stuff is done through Jetpack. You'll have your analytics. Yeah. Now, I'm old school in analytics. I have a program on my Windows machine that takes raw access logs. If you really want to find out what's going on your website, take those raw access logs and compile them. And then you really get to know what's going on. If you use Google will only give you so much data for free. You ever notice that? They want to charge you. Of course, because they want to make money, right? So, it's actually good that you get, that you're going over from WordPress.com to your own installation, but the people who are doing your installation, make sure you always get access to your raw access logs. Very important.
abstract themes, which seem to be popular. What's the difference between that and the regular themes?
The Bootstrap themes? Bootstrap is sort of like a frameworks, and they're done through a company. It's sort of like an in-house. It's very reputable, Bootstrap. We're also making a lot of inroads too, doing themes. I'd recommend. It's basically more. It's more. Simple.